doing that as much as possible, it's not going to allow them to win tournaments. That's for goddamn sure. But maybe it can win them this best of one.
Get to the best of three, so there's something that you want to do that gives you a bit more option. You need to make it through two lower bracket rounds, though, and this is, of course, lower bracket round number one still, and we are actually in the draft of CDEC taking on Team Newbie, as I hear some growling sounds coming up from the side.
I would never have guessed this. Never have guessed this.
There's like Nature's Prophet in the pool, there's Chen in the pool, there's Engendrus in the pool, there's VS in the pool, there's everything in the pool.
You know,
and
this,
you first pick a Doombringer.
It's a very classic Newbie pick in the sense of, so if we take Newbie to be Hao and Mu, who played together in Tong Fu for a long time, and then they played in Newbie, and then they split, and then they were back together. The team these two have been in has been drafting Doom forever. Although it was mostly back when they had like San Sheng and Banana, different players with them, so...
But it's like, is it still going to be effective? We just had a Doom in our previous game, we realized, oh wait, it can actually pick up a little bit, but then...
I know why.
Like, no way to just eliminate a hero like Doom used to, and she lay it on a Shiva.
Okay, so... Meta has been developing, and there's a reason I'm not officially an analyst, right? So keep that in mind. So meta is developing. They know that Team OG is one of the strongest team out there, and Team OG is the one that picked Doom. So they think, you know what? We're going to beat them to it. Doom is going to be the next level hero that everybody's going to contest for first pick, and we're going to just start doing it right now.
Damn it, Shiva. I was going to bring up OG.
That is a theory.
They just think one step ahead of the meta.
It is a theory.
Anything can be a theory.
I agree it's a theory.
Well, thank you.
Actually, no. I'm not going to say it's a theory at all. I think it's a hypothesis.
It has to be tested.
So if you're CDEC in that position, now they have picked. I think they might have considered their Bounty Hunter. When you see a Doom like this, of course, it could be played in a core position like mid or safe lane. I think the offlane Doom Bounty Hunter actually deals with fairly well, and especially the jungle Doom. But they're going to take the approach of going HBM. I think it's been very successful so far in the tournament. They do have players on the heroes. I don't see why it wouldn't work.
This looks very similar to the last game.
Is probably the reason they picked up Doom. Enchantress was still in the pool. It seems really obvious that an Enchantress BM would be a 1-2 punch from CDEC, and they preempt that.
Right, so they don't want the Enchantress themselves, so they just take the Doom. Is that...
Yeah, exactly. And we do know that Doom can work because of OG.
So far this is... picks Murd from last draft. Not the exact same order, but... The team, like the team that had Doom also had Phoenix, the team that had Enchantress also had Beastmaster.
I mean, it is in theory a pretty strong dueling. I don't think Vici played it particularly well last game. They played it all right. But there's a lot of damage between these two heroes, and a lot of healing too. Like, Doom walks in with Scorched Earth. If you angle the Sunray correctly, you heal Doom and damage the target. It's just a lot of DPS and difficult to zone out a lane entirely. So I could see Newbie making the same laning that Vici did. And this makes me wonder, did these teams just scrim against each other and develop their own like mini meta? And then it turns out to be bad against every other team than each other because they just didn't play so well. That's what I'm worried about for Newbie right now.
Another theory.
That is also a theory.
I was watching the Hazard video, looking back over the group stages and looking towards this, and he made a big point, which was that like China going up against China seems to be a lot closer when it comes to matches. Like the old stats, the patches actually make a lot more sense then, as opposed to watching a Western team going up against a Chinese team, or a Southeast Asian team even going up against a Chinese team. So. Maybe it does feel a lot more comfortable for these guys just to go for these kind of picks.
Why is no one picking Prophet?
And stick with that meta which you said they created.
Why is no one picking Prophet?
It feels so odd. Like I can understand why you prioritize like Beastmaster over Nature's Prophet, because like we've seen like his vision, his lane control with the boars, and having that one direct stun is wonderful, but a Doombringer over that? I don't know.
I want to talk about the picks at hand, actually, because the way that Newbie are setting this up, I think that a 4 and 5 position, Doom Phoenix, relies on you being able to have some cores that are heavy disablers that are able to provide a plethora of AoE disable, particularly, and Puck would have been such a good pickup for Newbie. CDC banned that one away immediately. Meanwhile, the CDC lineup with the Enchantress Beastmaster does already start off with a decent amount of pushing power, and you also want, because you're doing dual lanes, a core that is able to, that isn't too weak in the laning phase, that isn't going to be perhaps pushed around by some sort of strong aggro dual lane or even just a strong offlaner, like Furion, for example. That needs to be able to have some sort of self-sustain and come online relatively early, and I think Juggernaut's a great example of that. And then they ban away the Lina from CDEC. What a surprise.
I'm thinking about what they are considering for Shiki right now. What were his trademark picks at TI, which is when they did best? It was the Lina stood out.
The Viper?
Templar Assassin is not good against this, that's for sure. They're not picking TA into Doom Phoenix. His Viper was pretty good. His Razor was good. I'm just not sure how much his hero pool has developed, really.
He plays Invoker as well.
Yeah, it's bent.
Oh, yeah, the funny thing is, we were kind of like hyping it up before the group stage, and we're like, we've heard that, you know, Shiki has been practicing mids, you know, he's been playing Invoker a whole bunch, and then what happens in the group stage? He plays like Lina twice in a row or something like that, and I think he played an Invoker game, but it was really lackluster or something. It really does seem like Shiki's hero pool is still rather limited. It's growing, but it does seem to still be limited.
He plays Queen of Pain. He also...
I don't think Queen of Pain. I was thinking about Queen of Pain. I'm not sure if you want that against Doom, to be honest.
That's refreshing.
I would prefer your Viper suggestion, though.
The super interesting thing for me about Shiki is that actually... So before this team became like super mainstream and everyone followed them, I used to... The stuff that I was casting back then was the kind of tier 2 Chinese Dota. And his main hero when he first came into the team and replaced Maybe was actually Shadow Fiend. And he played it for like months on end, nonstop. Mm-hmm. And then at some point he just completely stopped. I mean, Shadow Fiend's not really in the meta right now, but it was interesting to me that he played the hero well for a long time and then just totally stopped and never played it again, to the point that most people don't even know that that's a hero he plays.
It hasn't even been picked once this tournament, has it?
Yeah. No.
That's actually unbelievable. It's not unbelievable, but it's interesting, rather. That such a big pick has fallen off completely based on... Well, to be fair, there's some pretty significant nerfs, but it's still a situational pick, and there are some players in this tournament that are extremely good at playing the hero, so you would think maybe they would fit it in.
The Rubick, again, against a Beastmaster.
And Weaver.
And great against Beastmaster.
It's the Weaver that triggered that pick, actually.
Yeah, it's
stealing. But great against BM, for sure.
So what do we look forward to seeing here from CDEC? Because so far, Newbie has got maybe a bit more team fight coming out compared to CDEC. Well, that was something that they lacked. Because the problem that they had during the group stages was, doesn't matter what kind of draft they had, if it was a pickup draft or anything else, they went for fights anyway, despite the draft. So you kind of want to look for something team fighty here as well?
It
because
sense,
that's their fighting style.
Like the last hero they're looking for, Ryze, is going to be the mid for CDEC.
Yeah.
Like, and if you are going for team fight, like, sometimes when you kind of wish they had a puck in this game or something along those lines that would give you that kind of control. And if it's not the control, maybe they just have to go for that raw burst damage. 5 seconds remaining. I mean, what else is really left for that? Like, you look for Quap, TA, things like that.
TA is not a pick this game.
Yeah, up against the Doom and the Phoenix. Yeah, you're right. You said it before. Like, it can't be done.
It's even worse now because of Rubick.
Yeah, but Queen of Pain's going to get shut down by the Doombringer. Who else is really left for the mid pick? Unless you go for something safer, like, would you actually be comfortable going for something like back, like the Lone Druid, which we've been seeing more and more in the mid? He's still in the pool at the moment.
I do think right now the most tempting pick for Shiki is Razor, but the PL makes it a little more tricky, I guess. It's a weird matchup because obviously you do have your passive against Lance, which is great, but when he comes up close, Razor actually has very few ways of dealing with it. Plasma Field doesn't kill the Illus, they just soak his ulti.
You only need the Line of the Beastmaster to do so much work to get that PL down.
I think they might be considering a hero for mid that has some sort of AoE control against that PL, because that is a really good pick right now. TA, like we talked about, not good. Shiki... Wait, they banned Pugna. Okay,
yeah,
that
Newbie
has to
be
a Nuka.
Newbie is the team that played Pugna, and actually almost won with it as well in the game during the group stages. It just lasted a bit too long for them to actually reach high ground more than one Rex, because they got one lane of Rex with that, but they couldn't continue breaking that, so...
Let's go, Shiki Tinker.
Shiki
Tinker?
Let's do it.
Is it possible...
He'll be ballsy.
Is it possible for them to put Shiki on Beastmaster and run the Enchantress offlane? Because XE does play Enchantress, definitely. I'm not sure if Shiki would play Beastmaster and would it be a good idea Because then their support has to kind of deal with the PL.
Everybody plays Beastmaster.
I'm going to say Shiki doesn't play Beastmaster. That's what I'm going to say.
I think it's too weak. I do think they have to pick a mid. Okay.
Oh, there we go.
That's a good solution for PL, but I think newbie kind of wanted this to happen when they have Doom and Rubick. They have an instant stun. They have obviously Doom is a great counter.
So this is something I started twice in the tournaments already, but actually Ember Spirit versus PL was roughly even in the previous patch when everyone said it was a counter. In this patch, Ember Spirit has won once against PL. It's lost 7 or 8 times. The PL keeps beating the Ember Spirit. I mean, it's not a huge sample, but definitely the sample doesn't show that Ember counters PL. So,
oh, I completely agree. I think that Ember Spirit is actually one of the weakest quote-unquote counters in the game against Phantom Lancer. It's, the Sleight of Fist isn't up enough for you to truly be able to counter the Phantom Lancer. You're so dependent on that CD.
It's the fire strat.
And if the PL goes on the Ember's in huge trouble, I think.
Yeah, I really like newbie's draft here.
I think the problem in this game, or rather something to keep in mind about Ember, is that now that Flame Guard is purgeable, Doom should remove it. So that actually makes the hero a lot weaker in that matchup, where in the past you get Doom, but if you at least have Flame Guard on, you can block that magic damage. But with it being purgeable since, I think, 2 patches ago, Doom still purges, right? With the same purging rules as it used to.
I believe, yes.
I'm pretty sure. So when that Flame Guard gets removed, Ember is actually just screwed in this game. He has to be really careful. We're probably looking at 2 heroes with Lincolns. So that's the flip side, I guess, is that Lincolns is now better against Doom because level death doesn't exist anymore and you can't, like, doesn't block Infernal Blade, it doesn't follow those rules.
Okay, Cap, yeah. What timing do these teams need to hit when they come to fruition for their lineup, you feel?
The biggest thing is actually going to be the Batrider's farm and him adjusting to be able to quickly shut down the Weaver as fast as possible. They need that Blink Dagger up real early.
Okay, and who do you favor?
I'm going to favor newbie for the Batrider.
Scant?
Moves to boss.
I think the very early game will decide this game, and I kind of think CDC have stronger support players, so I'm going to favor them.
Well, let's see who gets that Link Dagger fast enough to shut down the Weaver and how the early game goes for these 2 teams, as I will hand it over to Toby and Cinnarin for the last game of the evening. Team newbie versus CDC in another elimination match.
Thanks, Shiva. And because I think your opinion matters as well, Sindarin, I'd like to know your thoughts on this one. But I'm going to take it to the next.
Whoa. Wait, what? John has the cool Rubik set. Okay, go on.
Your opinion means nothing anymore.
See? That was easy. I spelled that very quickly.
It's the Puppet Master. It's actually taking us to Heroes of New Earth right here. No, but I actually want to take it to the next level on you. I want to give you the Blitz Challenge.
Okay.
And the Blitz Challenge is to work out exactly when what team would win.
For the win condition for either team or the team that actually
wins? The team that you believe will win and what timing they'll win. How do you get to that win condition?
Okay, CDEC will win minute.
You can have a 5-minute window.
Thirty to thirty-five. They will play the lanes aggressively. They will win them. They will get 1 or 2 Roshans and then slowly build a lead so that they can end with their Lincoln Spheres and then high ground with Weaver.
I could see that happening, but the issue you may be running into is just the effect of that Batrider as well as the Doombringer.
Absolutely.
Like, if these guys are able to get a couple of kills on the Weaver and the Ember Spirit, then CDEC's lineup is really not going to be that scary. That's when you feel like newbie could just like have the PL become an absolute beast and carry this game through.
That's just generally how it is, though, right? If you're playing 2 carry cores, if they both die a couple of times, the game is just hard. Yeah. So they have to play around that and avoid it. And I do think the key for avoiding aggression is putting on your own. If CDC take the more aggressive stance here and look to pressure lanes very early, they have newbie running around after them because they're just online earlier. I think Lion and Enchantress have a lot of ganking potential super early compared to Rubick. Is it a Phoenix support? No, it's a Phoenix offlane, so Rubick Doom.
That's why I'm a little bit surprised to actually look at CDEC, where they don't even buy a smoke, not even 1 smoke at the start of the game, and Enchantress is walking around with Obs and Sentries. She picked up a Wild Wing and actually ended up just straight farming up, stacking and just looking to flash farm over on this Enchantress. So it's going to take some time before she starts her rotation.
Well, she's already being annoying mid.
That's where the Wild Wing went.
You hate this so much. It's like the dumbest thing you can play against.
But Mu does have his bottle now, so he's at least able to spam out a little bit, but it does give the opportunity to Shiki if he can close the distance on Mu.
It is, by the way, really interesting to see Shiki play this hero, considering Aggressive is widely regarded as one of the best players in the world on the hero.
Yeah, he was actually, Aggressive was the one who played it for CDEC during the group stage as well.
Yeah, and he was outstanding at TI, like, just on another level on that hero. I think the other players that compete with him now for best Ember are maybe Eternal Envy, maybe a player like Ferrari, but we just don't see Ferrari that much, because IG don't really make
qualify for
events.
Small
but he is very faithful to his club. I think he's played for IG since TI2, maybe even before, maybe Dota 1. He's like, he goes as far back with IG as Dendy does with Na'Vi.
He definitely played for IG in Dota 1. I remember casting him at an SMM when he was playing for them. He's definitely been with them from the very, very start. Bottom lane, XZ, getting really harassed down, tried to go Happy Tree Tango kind of style out, but now picked up, thrown back down again. This should be first blood with the extra XZ, they didn't finish the job, he sounds up as well, and the doppelganger, Howl commit back underneath the tower. He's got the lands back off cooldown again, XZ with the board trying to create some space, but the lands will finally get the first blood.
It was a trick, he baited the south.
Possibly.
Nah. He baited Salve and Fairy Fire for an additional 180 mana for himself. That's a good trade.
He's going to come back to this lane with one Tango.
Yeah.
Like, that's all the Beastmaster's got to work with. This is rough. At least he's able to gain experience off this bottom lane. It's just how much he can get from here. Like, you hit level 3.5, 3 minutes in for your offlane Beastmaster. That's not too bad, but you're probably assuming you got more than one Tango charge.
Man, Q is being so farm-oriented this game with Ench so far. Like, he stacked the camps 3 times, he's just farming them now with his Hellbear. Looking to maximize here and just have... I mean, if they're getting away with it, it is an alternative way of playing the game, but I would like to see him in a more active role. The smoke has arrived, so...
Okay. But he needs a creep to actually go ganking with.
He's
like,
killing.
Ganking with a Wild Wing doesn't make a lot of sense. And a Hellbear doesn't really give you what you're looking for early on. Like, if you have a Troll Trap, potentially then you can have a follow-up into Assyrian Chains in mid, and a Centaur as well. Like, that's a nice little play to go for, but... would it be even better to go up on top? You need to wait until Devour's been used by Doom, though, before you can make that kind of play. As we were definitely proven in the last series.
Yeah, that is certainly a possible kill. Weaver, one of the better heroes, is just running down and killing Doom in lane, but he's already level 4, and this hero just has so much health. It's 800 health you need to chew through, plus Scorched Earth. He has boots, he has a stick. I actually think that kill is almost impossible. Maybe if they bring 2 good creeps plus they smoke in, but I just think there are better targets. I think the mid lane is where you want to go. You want to secure Shiki, a good start. Get an extra kill there, or you go for the long rotation to bottom, kill off the PL, and start threatening that tower with Beastmaster Aura. That's probably my favorite out of those two, but it's such a long rotation, and if it fails, it's such a big investment. So the alternative is, you know what, you can try for top. If it works, good. Then maybe you take the tower. If it doesn't, you have just wasted a hell of a lot of time.
It can work now. Like,
too late,
he got it off. And there's the stun. With the hoof stomp, the follow-up hex, that Doombringer is going nowhere but down.
It is enough.
He was really apprehensive today. You can see Tule having that decision. Like, I know they're missing, but what are you going to do? You're going to live in fear? Enchantress could just be flash farming in the jungle. With 2 very defensive wards on the map for newbie, like, you don't really see much. Like, you don't see that rotation coming out from the Enchantress.
He was not that far from surviving as well. If he gets the 5-stick charge off and maybe pops, I guess he can't salve with the Scarab on him, so that makes it a little bit harder. But not too far. Maybe Scorched Earth level 3 there and a little bit extra will keep him alive, but definitely a good kill for CDC, but it doesn't bring anything extra with it. They don't even deal a single point of damage to the tower in that move, I think. And committed a lot, they give information. Chuan is just being super greedy bottom, just pulling, stacking, pulling. Already level 4.5. Newbie's early game, I think, is going the way they wanted it to.
It actually seems like both teams are very comfortable with where this game is. Like, you both won 1 on the board. As far as gold goes, it's actually it's flat. Like, now there's 20 gold difference, but, like, there's very little in this game between the two teams. Obviously, you're only 6 minutes in, but the fact that it's very little between the teams when you're also running a Doombringer, like, you think there's normally a little bit more, but it's because, like, Tule only went for 1 point up in Devour. Everything else he's pumped into Scorched Earth and having that one value point up in Infernal Blade early on. But I want to keep my eyes a little bit closer on Hal. He's had a lot of farm on this bottom lane. He's got the one and only kill of newbie so far. and is currently sitting at that like 900 gold after already having the Ring of Aquila and a full magic wand. Like, sitting at a level 7 PL, getting a lot of momentum, that's looking great for him. And I'm not really feeling the same threat from aggressive, especially if Lincoln's is going to be his build. It normally takes you like 22, maybe 24 minutes before you're really a threat in the fight, because you got to build Lincoln's, and then maybe you also go the Deso or you go something else.
I think you're underestimating how much damage the Swarm deals. That skill is really, really
good. But he's only put
now.
1 point up in.
Yeah, he's going to max it next. If he does the right, at least that would be the build I would agree with. Most of the time nowadays, we see Weavers similar maxing the Swarm. In the past, you would go 1-4-4. Now you just go 4-4-1 because it got buffed a couple of times, and this skill is amazing.
Curious snipe time. Free res? No free res. They hold on, and they're patient.
Yeah, this is a pretty big kill, especially if it's on Hal. And he might not expect it because XZ is only level 5.
Nice. He's still got Doppelganger though, so you come in and you want to go for the Searing Chain.
Oh, he
chained the air. First. So Hal can only be enchanted up by Q, but he's already back into the safety of the tier 1 tower, and Sean was very close by as well.
That actually made no sense approaching that gank that way. This is flat out just a misplay from Shiki. He has to hold the chains there and just start running with Flame Guard. And... yep.
It also
that's
seems
a missed opportunity. Well, aggressive.
Yeah.
He could kill.
Well, that's... he dove under a tier 2 tower to kill that Phoenix on the top lane. He was under a tier 2 tower to get that kill. Living up to his name, aggressive. This is actually probably further than I've seen, like, normally, like, a Turtle Envy dive, and he's running down those lanes with phase boots on, just over-harassing the hero and using time-lapse to just negate all of the damage.
It's an awful lane matchup for Phoenix. This is one of the worst heroes you can play against. You can't hit your Fire Spirits very well. It's very difficult when he's Shikuchi'd. Getting rid of the Swarm is hard because your attack speed, it takes a long time. And like you said, he can actually chase you when you use Icarus Dive. Mm-hmm. Aggressive can run him down here. And takes full advantage of his knowledge of this matchup. Starting to put some pressure on the top tower as well. Getting chains.
There's your last suit. Drag him back. Triggered off the Doom as well. They're going to pick him up and throw him down.
Okay, he got ganked.
Yeah, that's a lot of insurance though being used. But it's the Ember Spirit dropping. And this is what we talked about, like, that newbie need to do. They need to get a couple of pickoffs on the course. That's one way to start it. Slow down that Ember Spirit. Make sure that Battle Fury cut timing isn't looking good.
One thing I'm wondering for CDC is why they decided to approach the game the way they did with the Enchantress and just play it greedy in the jungle when we've seen other teams running Enchantress Beastmaster offlane with great success. And sure, you could argue, yeah, you're playing against a Doom, but Devour has a really long cooldown level 1. It's 70 seconds, maybe he eats one creep, or maybe you just keep the creep away from him. Let's say you get a Harpy, you just flank and you keep chain lightning that PL, he's going to lose the lane by default.
It makes sense, and Q's build actually leans towards that. Like, you've got an Urn and just basic boots over on this Enchantress. If this isn't like an Enchantress that should be looking to fight, like...
it's just too late now to play that way. If he wanted to do it, he should have done it from minute one.
Which has to mean then they have to be looking to group up as a full squad. Like, that's the only other way this really makes a lot of
seems
sense,
like,
but you've
also
delayed, like, XZ, because he's going for... I don't know if he's actually going to complete up the treads or if he's just going to go to Necrobook, but it's an Iron Talon Beastmaster, but no one's ready to come and gank with him. Like, the Lion is almost level 6, and that's going to be nice for Garda. Blink Dagger is 1,000 or so away.
Yeah, he's reaping a lot from this. 21 CS minute 10 on Lion is very, very high.
So, they got a lot of space on the heroes. So why don't you think, like, CDEC are in a position where they can play the roaming, ganking kind of game?
I think they can. They just chose not to. Maybe they want to play it a little more safe since it's a best of one. Secure their lanes, get their level 6 on Lion, which they have. Both their supports are level 6, so that's great, but it's the same on the other side. And you basically traded with a Doom Rubick, who just have really impactful ultimates, right? And you've, in addition to that, just given Batrider free reign over his jungle. He has 60 CS minute 10. 10 minute Blink Dagger Smoke Tranquil's bottle. He's super rich and ready to go. So I don't really agree with this approach from CDC. I think it's too passive, and we're going to see. If this smoke works out for newbie, it's definitely transitioning into a tower, and then they can look to take more control. But counter smoke is there.
Yep.
Kufan 2.
It's going to be Garda, but a very quick blink away from Moon means the Garda can't capitalize.
Well, okay then.
But they brought everybody, so newbie aren't giving up on this. They brought all 5 heroes to this top lane. And now with the rotation of Shiki as well, we're about to get into our first big team fight of this series.
Keep an eye out for Doom. This is the most important ability in this fight. If he can Doom the Ember after Haste Flame Guard, he will get both abilities purged. But if he casts it on anyone else, Shiki is a monster in the upcoming fight.
Looks like Newbie doing a bar of it. The BTs are already up on Howe, that was his first primary item. And he just goes straight in the bottom lane. If CDEC brought everyone up, they're fine with this. And CDEC wanted a fight like that, a nice Observer Ward, which will now time out in 4 seconds on the top lane. So it was seeing pretty much everything that Newbie was bringing to the top lane. CDEC were very much aware and they wanted to go into it. But with Newbie denying it, CDEC just have to go back to the farming. Back to the stacking, back to all that kind of jazz.
And when do they make a play now?
You could look for the Blink Dagger timing online as a play, but you're still like waiting another three, four minutes, maybe five for that.
I do think their teamfight is really strong when Aggressive is level 10, and the Ember still has the haste. It's going to be auto-activated now, I think. It just, it expired. So he will be getting an Arcane Rune, and no, never mind, that's going to Howe. Because that's another great rune in Ember. He's actually getting pretty lucky with the rune rotation here and could have made some plays, but they don't do it. Maybe their read on the game is, you know what, we can just try to farm, get our Lincolns up, and then maybe go Rosh with that, because then Doom is a lot weaker. But the newbie lineup have plenty of ways of breaking those Lincolns if that's what they're farming for. They have Fate Bolt, Rubick Lift, Lance, I guess Lasso doesn't count. You don't really want to Lincolns that. So, but the tools are there. That's the most important part, is that they have a way of dealing with it.
And Nubi are reading this gank really, really nicely. They have an Observer Ward watching over on the bottom river, which is the reason why they're TPing out. And again, they bring fire players up to the top lane. Now Q is playing around with Ellie on that Phoenix by just troll trapping him up. But the T1 tower comes under pressure. CDEC will pressure out the bottom tower. Okay, and they're actually going to completely abandon the top tower now. So it becomes trade time.
I like this trade for CDC. I think the Radiant tier 1 tower is a bit more important and gives them better access to Roshan as well. Probably access into the enemy jungle. They have the Beastmaster advantage, so trading towers arguably gives them more map control than the enemy team. So I think that's pretty alright. At the same time, newbies shouldn't be too bothered by this. They, like you said, the rotations are fine. They're not getting killed in this early game that could have been hard.
They might be concerned that they're not getting to that tier 1 tower in time.
They just smoked on top of a ward. Aggressive knows this is happening. They're coming down to mid. And this is just free time for CDC bottom. If they read this right, they could deal a lot of damage to this tower because they know these heroes don't want to TP down. They want to run all the way.
They already took half life of that tier 1 tower with just the creep wave momentum and a little bit of health from Aggressive.
Yep.
And with the position of Aggressive too, like, he'll see Mu coming. You're obviously not expecting detection over on Nubi, but Chorn is walking around with some dust. That's too late. That smoke movement forward, it's now going to break. No dire Observer Wards around this area though, so CDC have no idea, but again, we go into this play where, again, they back off. CDEC get control of the side lanes, they got their tower trade they were searching for, and they'll just be happy with this.
Maybe they're trying to play on the fatigue of their opponents, and they think they have more energy to play this game at 2 a.m. than the enemy.
The level of patience. See,
whoever drops to the floor last wins.
No letter KO. Hey, I'm down with that one.
I'm not.
The game just goes in an eternal loop until you pass out on your desk.
I mean, at this rate, the game will be at least 2 hours with the amount of kills you usually see before a game ends, so...
They really are dodging, too. Like, I'm trying to remember, like, the exact game it reminds me of, but it's, I think it was LGD, was one of the teams, back at, TI4, and it was just like, the second you thought a fight was gonna happen, they backed off. Like, smoke happened, they backed off, went all the way into their base, and never came out, and then they waited until the timer ticked out where the smoke would expire, and then came back out to farm up their jungle, they smoked again, hide yourself away. It was like watching Chastity Dota.
Oh, did those scarabs? Yeah, they did hit Howe.
Yeah, top lane, Cheeky.
He's taking quite a lot of damage. This is a play.
They were waiting for the doppelganger to come out, so then Cheeky can initiate. And with a double damage rune too, Cheeky is so quick. The Tule's TP was a little bit too late, but Mu's looking for an opening, and he's gonna find Garda. Garda turns for the moment, goes for the stun, and Cheeky wants to keep going. He's still got this double damage rune with the Searing Chains, Aggressive moving forward. Nice little Shikuchi to steal from Chorn. They pop off the line with the last, and they drag Aggressive back. He can't get the time lapse off in time, and Chorn takes himself a double kill. And what's your trade-off? You lost your PL, you took the Weaver as well as the Lion. You'll have some significant damage done to your tier 1 tower mid as well as tier 2 on bottom.
Yeah, that's an okay trade for CDC. I thought that was going to go better. When Lion was allowed to turn, cast Earthspike and Finger on that bat, I actually thought they could kill him off. It's understandable that Shiki doesn't want to hard commit to that kill, because if he stays in melee range with a Flame Guard, he risks getting lassoed and then doomed, and as we talked about, then you just purge off the Flame Guard and he actually doesn't even deal damage. At the end of the day, though, I think they should have probably tried to commit for that bat kill and then see how it develops from there, because instead you got a free lasso off.
Sorry, just came in a very long way. Without Doppelganger up, Shiki jumps in, but Doppelganger away. That bottom tower's within deny range, so CDEC, if they want this, they'll have to commit for it, and they're not going to. So Howl will just snipe that tier 2 on bottom lane.
This is still some pretty relevant map control being claimed by CDEC.
Too late? Aggressive's right behind, but Gardam needs to be the man leading that charge. There's no way they get the kill that way. But at least Lion's now got the money for his Blink Dagger.
Regen for Shiki. Good stuff. And I'm imagining maybe Q will skill the fourth point in Untouchable with this next level up. Something to keep in mind for Roche. Actually, the lineup is really good at the Swarm. They have Untouchable, the Beastmaster Aura, Necro Book.
A lot of things to work with.
Should be
and getting
able
to an Aegis Immortal on someone like a Weaver basically gives Aggressive a license to kill. But he's already got the Lincoln Sphere, so maybe it's worth protecting the Ember Spirit a little bit more if you do pick up that Aegis. How? Bottom lane, Q. Diffuser Blade is up, which means Q can't run anywhere. Sean will make sure of it, going for the Puppet Master style. And Q on the sidelines. But again, another tower being pressured. And another tower being within deny range, with that catapult attack is now down 121. But this will remove, like, the second tier 1 tower now of Newbie. Which means they've got no frontal positions to really work with, and they need to have some really good vision to make the Batrider pickoffs work. And you want it, like, Moo's got himself a Blink Dagger and a 4-star.
Yeah, he's still doing very well on the Batrider in the farm department. It still looks like a pretty even game. And for me now, it's going to come down to who gets Roshan control and starts getting the Aegises. I still would argue that CDC could have done more with their early game, but what they at least accomplished with their playstyle was that they got Lion a fast Blink Dagger from all the greed top and all the farming. Beastmaster is, I guess, a little bit behind as a result because they didn't help him that much in the lane, but the other cores are actually keeping up fairly well, and this is a very difficult game to predict in late game. Both teams with good late game, I guess PL obviously great late. If it goes super late, I would say that Ember is one of the very good counters. They were talking about how it hasn't been that good so far, but most of the games is because the PL just play super aggressive in the early mid portion of the game before the matchup favors Ember a lot more. And they also have a Weaver. So double physical damage in CDC against, you know, Doom that hard counters out the one and then the PL. Very difficult to call a game.
That's why I'm interested to see with the build from Hal. Because normally if you're going up against something like an Ember where you feel like you're going to get outdone, like you get something more like a Blink Dagger into BKB into Abyssal Blade. So you get that straight lockdown control over on the Ember Spirit. Or you rely on your support heroes to have some more disable up their sleeve. But that's a little difficult with that lineup.
Yeah, now it's about time for CDC to do this. Once again, I think they could have done it earlier, but it's still the right play. Yeah. Getting this. You probably put this Aegis on, I would say, the Weaver with the Lincolns, and then you can frontline for their tower pushers. Probably take their tier 1 top for free, then maybe break into a fight for a tier 2, unless Niobe want to give you both towers, which you're obviously very happy with. Or you just map control and farm and get your Battle Fury on Shiki before you start making your aggressive play. I actually like that one the most because he's so close and it's such a key item that just relaxing a little bit for that is probably a good call.
I'm loving this aggressive Observer Ward from CDEC. Just around the middle, it's only got one, like half a second left on it, but it just keeled over right next to where Newbie are about to smoke themselves up. And they actually just sentry to look for it and then smoke themselves up too. So CDEC will at least have the information that three players from Newbie were gathering there. They can extrapolate that is in fact a smoke move from Newbie, and they may not get killed off here, but it looks like XC is already a little bit too far out. With no Blink Dagger on this Beastmaster and Garda already bailing into the trees, yeah, okay, they put up the Hawk. They'll break the smoke on Moo. He instantly, like, Fireflies in, gets that lasso off, and XC is dead. Just count your losses. That's it. Bail out.
It looked like he hesitated with the roar. He wasn't sure whether he should commit it, and I guess if you're dying anyway, you might as well, right? It's not that long of a cooldown, but
only 80 seconds.
I don't think it would have made a difference. He would have died there anyway. And that's one of the strengths of Batrider, obviously, is that when the smoke breaks, he is not scared of, like, he will often see the target immediately from the flying vision, and he's in these kind of situations, he's not scared of just blinking in and looking for the kill.
Yeah, the only concern is, like, when you burn a smoke like that, yes, you kill off a Beastmaster, but you're not stopping the Ember and the Weaver from getting anything else, and the smoke is still on cooldown. So they won't have a new smoke for another 2 minutes now, for newbie. So these ganks are going to become, like, a lot fewer with the smoke movements out.
If they get a tier 1, I still think it's a good play. If they got the kill on its own, that's probably not even worth the smoke.
They may not get it, though. Like, that tier 1 talent's already been taken out by, okay, by CDEC.
They're definitely getting this.
And, like, how... Okay, it is a full trade, yeah. It's a 1-for-1.
But CDC can force the rotation as well, because they have this... They know Lassoy's on cooldown for a bit, they have the Weaver with the Lincolns. Tule can't really do anything about it yet.
They just got the Battle Fury over on Shiki.
Yep. Keep an eye out for the Shadowblade on the Doom, though, making the plays. It's still... He still solo kills Shiki if he comes in.
Cool. Bottom lane, Blink, Lasso. Gonna be dragging back XZ and Beastmaster. Got no way out of this one. He'll go for the roll, and this time there's no hesitation to use it, as his Necro units just run themselves away. Ends up losing both of them to the PL.
Now there's also a lens on Moo. This item is so good on Batrider. It's exceptionally good. Longer engage range on Blink, longer pull range with Force Staff. The cast range on Napalm might actually be the best part of it though. It's so good being able to cast that from further away. But yeah, this is the build order that most Batriders go nowadays, I feel. I think some people experimented with getting Blink into Lens first, and then Force Staff. But it's just the more logical order is to do it this way. And then, of course you shouldn't forget that there's also spell damage on it. And it all adds up. It's a very good item.
Yeah, most of the time you just look for that repositional item first. That's the beauty of the Force Staff. Like, it means you can fight the team fights in wherever you want to do it. Well, not exactly wherever you want to do it, but pretty much more on your terms than the enemies. And there's no one that really stops the Batrider in this game. Like, normally it's like something like a Wisp or like someone that's at least gonna like mess around, like the Oracle, as we saw during the games early today. Like, there's just no... Oh, sorry, during the group stage. Like, there's just no way that Batrider can get a proper lasso off when Oracle just, like, burns his ulti.
I do think there was an Oracle earlier today.
Yeah.
Liquid
versus
Alliance.
It was today.
They lost that game, though. But...
Details.
Well, they could have won it. They were looking so good in that game. That was actually great from Liquid. Yep. It's a little bit quiet. Is there a smoke on the CDC side? No! They're actually just standing 5 heroes behind their tier 2 tower, probably expecting a rotation out of the enemy team. The Hawk is going to give some good information. They're going to see Batrider, and that's probably going to give them the confidence to move uphill. You'll see, well...
So the fact it's also like 3 minutes until CDEC have themselves a smoke. For a game which only has 10 kills in 24 minutes, it's amazing how much smoke has been burnt. It's actually 11 minute cooldown over on the newbie smokes, and that's because you're currently looking at one smoke over on Phoenix.
Yeah.
And they just burnt it. So they don't have another smoke for 11 minutes. This has to work from newbie to give themselves a little bit more space on the map.
This is actually pretty good timing because the Aegis expires in 10 seconds for the Weaver. I think CDC should have tried to use this somehow. But instead, now they might be caught out. It looks like they have a pretty good read on the map though, and just dodge entirely. And these smokes just being wasted for newbie is a really big deal. Like you said, 11 minutes. Chon misclicking here using TP by mistake. So that's on cooldown as well. It's going to be difficult for newbie to keep finding picks if they just throw away their smokes like this.
Yep, unsuccessful one. Like, all that smoke managed to do was give them extra movement speed to reach the bottom lane just that little bit quicker.
They got a ward up. And that's the way they find the picks. Like, they need some sort of vision, and they're playing against a Beastmaster. That's why they've bought a gem on the Phoenix, the Shadow Blade on Doom, and the Batrider with the Blink. They will be looking to make the map dark for CDC so they can find the picks. They realize that this is all about the vision, and it's 100% correct. Like, this, it's a vision game right now.
CDC are reading the movements of newbie pretty damn well. Like, while aggressive as well as Shiki are currently sitting inside the jungle, they're adding so much pressure to the top lane. Like, the PL is here to defend it, so Howe as well as, like Ellie, they're just there to make sure this push does not succeed from CDEC. But they put this Observer Ward down a long time ago. Garda was actually the man to do it, and he was waiting for someone to come out, and the only person who came was actually Tule. And he instantly said, I can't do this. Especially when he didn't have a lot of help behind him. But now he waits, now he does have help, but they have to keep split pushing it out. Like, the TP down the bottom lane so she can push it out, and then he'll just come back to his spirit on top lane. Actually, did he leave one up there?
He has a remnant active, but I don't know where it is. Oh, it's in their small camp.
Okay.
Top. It will expire soon, though. He might just flame guard.
There you go. That's what they're waiting for. Very quick, very easy, very effective.
At some point, someone's gonna show. And then they die.
He waited. He was very, very patient.
Yep. I don't think that was the kill they were hoping for. I think the most valuable kill there is probably the PL. Or the Batarang. The Batarang is actually most valuable because of the gem. And he will now find the ward because they're like, okay, we actually got jumped here. There's probably vision.
Doombring has found a target. Ashley starts instantly with that Infernal Blade, goes into the Doom, and Chiki should die now. There's no TV support coming. Okay, now it comes, but it's a little too late there. No ability to deny up the Ember Spirit. So a solo kill for the Doombringer, and all you have to do was walk up, hit him, blade him, doom him.
Yep. This is going to be a problem for Chiki the whole game, unless he gets a Lincoln's. Then Doom can't solo kill him anymore, unless if he itemizes so that he can break Lincoln's, but that's already, you know. Then you've at least accomplished that. And like I said, it was just a matter of time for the Phoenix, it's also a matter of time for CDC. They've dodged well, but at some point, you're going to make a misstep. And it costs them. I think this is going to cost them a tower, because they're currently set up for a 4-on-4 top, but I think not having this Ember is just too big of a problem. It's the only way they really deal with the PL, and Newbie acknowledging that, just go straight for the tower. And CDC won't have any of this fight, I think. Doesn't look like it.
Are they going to fortify anyway?
Dual Glyph! Okay, maybe. Maybe they can make it here.
Yeah,
Garter
is jumping. Gotta get the hex off. The follow-up stun, yeah, she hits the stun. But Aggressive cannot go through that stun ray. Elise feels very apprehensive about doing so. But the damage into Ellie is so big. He'll go for the Nova. Aggressive, they're all around it. They're just gonna start attacking into it. And, yep, they do bring down the Phoenix. House TP out. Shiki steering chains. He actually stops him. House a doppelganger himself over into the tree line. Creates a whole bunch of new cells. And then Shiki, holy Hannah, he gets destroyed by Hal. And then Hal, well, he will pay the price for it, but he still gets himself a solo kill over on the Ember Spirit. So it's not a complete loss, even if they do lose the Phoenix as well.
And that's, you know, you kind of hate to say it, but that's probably one of those moments where Aggressive just doesn't die on Ember. He realizes, okay, Slight Chains is the play. I stop the TP. PL's counterplay potential against me with all his mana burn. I need to Slight Chains it just back. Wait for my team, and we go up again. There's like no escape for the PL there. He can't possibly juke them when they have a hawk and when they have the swarm. But end of the day, they still get a good trade. Two kills for one, tier two is also theirs, and they managed to defend that top tier two, which is also very important. So still very good for them. Garter going in.
Real nice hex, that's over on Chorn, but Garter, that sunray just keeps burning him out. It's still a two for two, considering we've got those other two heroes still on the deck. Atule able to run himself out of there.
Well, he is low.
He's got a lot more leap ability to get out. And he is low, but the Necro units are not chasing in any further there. And they're finally going to get mopped up, at least one of them, by the Doombringer. Now, CDEC. And they really don't want to pull off right now. They want to keep fighting, and a lot of it's coming off the back of the line initiation. I want to give massive props right now to Garter. He's always in the front lines, always encouraging his team to move forward.
Yeah, not scared to make the aggressive play. Never refuse. By the way, you remember that we were playing the Blitz game, right? And I said,
yep.
60 to 65 minutes.
That is not what you said.
Yeah.
You said 32 to 37, I believe it was.
Let's say I said that. That helps. Yeah.
60 to 65 minutes, I heard it.
Thank you, Cap.
I think you're muted, Cap.
Cap, you're here in spirit. That's all that matters. But, okay, so seriously, I think I said 30 to 35. My chances are diminishing very quickly.
Yeah, this game could just drag
but it's
further,
also not
going to
be
like
an hour-long game.
Like,
you just
like,
got this feeling.
You see Weaver pick up this kind of item. Like, you go for a Lincoln's, you go into a Deso, and BKB is your next major item. Like, you can understand it after what he just saw happen to the Ember Spirit.
He almost, like, it's very difficult to see Aggressive die, and then he's going to have an Aegis too. Most likely, Newbie will try to contest this, and they're doing the right thing with the Batrider gem, making sure the area is clear first. But CDC can still find a very good initiation angle here. And if they've paid attention, they will know Doom is on cooldown for a bit. It's a long cooldown nowadays. Do they have a smoke ready? They just bought one for Garter. And this is, or on Q rather. This is the biggest moment of the game, probably. If they get a good teamfight and get the Roche, they could even transition it into Rax, or at the very least, it very clearly.
They might actually get a lot more, because Hal just spent his money to pick up a Reaver. He's trying to finish up a full heart, which means Hal doesn't have buyback. It also then means, if CDC win the fight, they're probably going to go for Roshan, so you won't have to expend the buyback. But if CDC have some momentum on the bottom lane, which actually, no, they don't. So yeah, they're not going to force the buyback anyway, so it's not really that much of a risk.
They're going to find... No, never mind. They move
they're
going
to find the illusions and not initiate on the illusions. Gotta blink like he was going to. Now the smoke will break. Hal's going to be visible. The Searing Chain's actually working. Tule as well as Chor getting caught by that. Tule, the impetus damage is just too much. Gotta might have been dragged back out by the last two, but that Nova is well out of position. They're not really hurting anyone from C to EZ, as it's just all up to Shiki to bounce himself around the Fusil Blade or not. You've lost two cores here from Newbie. Phoenix is back up again, and they're all just trying to TP the hell out of here. The only one who cannot do it is Mu, and he's the big one because he's walking around with a gem. He cannot afford to lose this. The Scarab Bugs are coming over, Mu will go down, and the gem is now in the hands of CDEC.
If they see it.
He
dropped it 2 seconds before he died, right above this tree, and it's actually pretty difficult to see that if you're not in position. This is a very good play if they get away with that.
Are they
going to
send the courier?
Not so far.
I'm not seeing the Dire Courier go out. It's still currently sitting over at the shop. Which is funny considering how much money is currently holding on to.
Oh, put the Aegis on Ember. Interesting. And I guess he's the logical Doom target, so with that logic...
It'll also allow him to buy up his full Daedalus and feel a lot more secure.
Yeah, it's just way harder to siege high ground when you're... You know, when your siege vehicle doesn't have the Aegis. That's Ember's biggest weakness in the late game. He is not good at destroying buildings. Weaver, on the other hand, is very, very good.
I'm assuming that Newbie is assuming the CDC have already taken the gem. Or else they would be sending that courier on a scout, or like dropping his items. Because you've got a Shiva's Guard recipe as well as a Reaver at the moment.
It is actually very surprising that they didn't just send over a Hawk. Because they would have known he had that gem. He's had it for a while, He had it in the fight, and they haven't scouted the area yet. In a way, it's not that important because they have their own gem, and as long as Newbie don't pick it up, it actually doesn't matter. Because they still have gem advantage. But, you know, it's nice to get it back. Maybe it'll stay there the rest of the game. Maybe in a moment, Mu just forgot.
It's quite possible. If that creep wave doesn't push out, like, far enough, they won't even get the vision from the side. Like, I believe during daytime, you will be able to see up to that gem area. But during nighttime, you will not.
It's daytime. They can't see it. The creeps don't see that. The wave.
They don't?
No.
Okay.
So, well... Guess they won't discover that anytime soon.
we'll keep checking in on it every 5 minutes, don't worry. Middle lane now, the pressure gets to come in from C to EC. Having that Desolator over on Aggressive definitely helps out. He's actually still he's increasing his attack speed as well by having that Hyperstone up his sleeve. And aggressively showing the fact that he has that Lincoln Sphere by bubbling up.
There goes the tower. Slowly but steadily. This is a big item, by the way, on the Doom. This gives them a fighting chance at getting a better place Supernova and having it not be countered. Of course, the attack speed slow aura on that is very significant. Something we didn't mention in the draft is how Weaver naturally works well against Phoenix because of the Geminate attack hitting twice on the egg.
Yep.
That played a role in a couple of fights earlier.
Yeah. And if Weaver keeps getting more and more attack speed, then it's going to be like Weaver can just do it by himself without any kind of help from his team.
Yeah, currently the Supernova is only level 2. He actually can in BKB. I think he can take it down alone.
Mm-hmm.
At least with the Beastmaster aura next to him. That's a guaranteed.
Well, CDC again. What do you want to do? Now you've taken all the outer towers. You've got an Aegis D-model, so you definitely want to force an issue somehow. But you got a Batrider that's hunting you down, fire flying up near their own secret shop.
I think the perspective is a little bit different now as far as forcing the issue. I would have liked them to use the previous Aegis because they didn't have map control, but now that they've taken all the towers, they can actually just farm and be content. Because Newbie it's very, very difficult to see a win condition for them in that teamfight that... You know, previously the way they could win fights was just Doom Shiki and play around that. But Dooming the Weaver, next impossible. Dooming Shiki, sure you could do it, but he has Aegis. And you're playing against a lineup that has Gem, has superior vision on you, and is just farming in your jungle and everywhere. So, CDC can approach it this way for now. I would like to see them use the Aegis, but I think it's more understandable that they don't try to use this one.
It seems like a very, very, very difficult task to say the least.
Oh, is that a new gem? No, never mind. It's just a sentry ward in that area.
That would be a pretty expensive expense to have right now for newbie, and they're gonna
try and find him. He lays in pretty damn close, but who's he gonna doom right now? He's just backing up. Mu is so low. Batrider already down for the count. Q's trying to run himself away, and Hal, all he's doing is spending his time trying to chase down this Enchantress, which he is able to achieve. While Aggressive was ripping into LE, but they find Chuan. That's the bigger pickoff. Just outside, instead of having to dive inside the base. But you took 2-for-1. It's not bad.
Doom...
But it's not really enough to go high ground yet.
Doom wasn't used. You know, if CDC wanted to, again, they still have an Aegis. I feel like they should force a buyback here at the very least. There's 40 seconds on that Aegis. It's like perfect timing. Maybe you force a buyback and you're just completely hard disengaged. Ember just goes in and hits that tower and he can jump away. But they're playing it very, very, very safe here. Which
it's
is
like they
kind of uncharacteristic for CDC, to be honest. The old CDC would push for that tower,
yep.
I'm sure.
But instead they're waiting for Q to respawn up and then they go again, but then everyone's back alive. And they got to look for these big openings. But they don't expend any big abilities. Like, you still got that level 2 Finger of Death from Lion. That nuke wasn't even triggered. And hilariously enough, like, Tule found himself in the middle of CDEC and decided to hold the Doom. So both teams were like, yeah, this isn't like the real fight. This is just like the prelude.
He couldn't Doom anyone. His only target that he could see was Weaver. And that's not a target at all.
Yeah.
And if he can see Ember, that's actually not a target either. Really.
It really is like a terrible decision of who you target.
Well, now the Aegis has expired. Hal has the heart. Plays are available now for a newbie. When's their next smoke? Do they have one again? Has it already? Yeah, they do. They have one in Tron. I think you save this smoke for Roche. And just push out the lane, chill, because that is such a crucial moment.
It's gonna be hard.
Unless your CDC are just gonna use it to farm. But it's still, there's a cheese on it, that one doesn't expire.
The CDC are gonna be so quick on Roshan.
Yeah, they kill it really fast.
Like, the Aggressive actually has enough money now, he can finish up his full Assault Cuirass.
Yeah.
And you've got that Blink Dagger sitting in the... Well, it's just in the stash right now of the Ember Spirit. But he can bring that out pretty quickly. And Beastmaster is obviously Beastmaster. Like, he's every aura you need to bring down Roshan. A CDC are going to lose their tier 2 tower on top, but it looks like they want to play a game of chicken at the moment. Like, there's a big creep wave going in through the top in favor of newbie. The first TPs are already coming back from newbie, and CDC, they are going to go high ground. It's just illusions that were entering the base of CDC, so no one really is left from newbie on the top. But they're forced to fortify now.
Yeah, they're not going to go for more than this. They popped their book, they got the glyph, they have too much gold on the courier. There's a full AC available to be delivered for Aggressive if he wants it. Hasn't bought it yet, but probably just waiting for the courier to pick up the pieces and then send it to the secret shop for the plate mail. And, you know, you got what you came for. If they push then, it really doesn't make sense. Like, they literally just had an Aegis expire 1 minute earlier. They haven't picked up a single key item since then. Why would they suddenly go now?
Yeah.
This, however, could be a moment, because, again, Beastmaster advantage, good vision in the Radiant Jungle. You can see Nubiar is terrified of moving out of the map.
There's nowhere they want to come out. Like, Chaun's just being so quick. It's like, Feybolt, 4-star back out. You almost want to draw a perimeter that, like, if you ever cross this line on your mini-map, like, you come in force.
Yeah.
And you're actually seeing the circle being drawn out right now by movies. It's like, I know they are here, but that may not help them. The stun from Gala is going to miss thanks to the 4-star. Coming out from newbie, the pickup will be over on the Enchantress, and again, Q finds himself on the firing line. As, they try and make some space into the Nova. Q still on the run out of here. They get rid of the PL Illusion, but Mu, he's dragging Q back in. Man, this is some serious commitment to kill off an Enchantress.
They've been hating on him all game. I feel like these fights...
It's at least slowing down his Aghanim Scepter, but he's only 2,000 gold away from that, and they don't stop Aggressive or Shiki. You just burnt... Like, okay, last suit's not that long.
I used Lasso Nova, it's not too bad. Once again, no Doom used. This is a short Roche respawn. So that's actually pretty interesting. Oh,
see,
okay.
Jumping in, goes to the roar over on LE. The follow-up stun and Beastmaster! He's dying too quickly!
Huh?
These PL illusions are just destroying them.
Did they just willingly engage into a 4-on-5 like
yes.
that? They know all of the heroes are there.
Yes. We said this, like, we said this on the panel before we started this, where we'd have these moments where we're just like, okay, Syndrome, please explain the non-logic.
Like, that's not how I work. I generally explain logic.
Yeah. Which was the peril we knew we were going to enter into in this game.
I don't know what to say about that. That was just
it felt
that's a late night show with CDC play right there, I think.
This is also a really bad timing because it's 30 seconds now that Newbie have without the Beastmaster on the field, and Mu just scattered Roshan as well. If Newbie are quick enough about this, they can take Roshan.
I don't even know if CDC scouted it themselves, which is, you know...
They haven't looked in yet.
They don't have a Hawk because guess who's dead? And they haven't thrown in the Scarabs. Man, this is such a steal. Oh my, if Newbie get this. This is like the biggest blunder of the game by CDC by far.
Do you give it to the PL? Like, does he drop the Ring of Aquila and then you try and force down a lane?
Yeah, I think so. You at least take the tier 2 towers if you make it. But this could get close. No,
No, they're too far away.
Aw, man, they're gonna be hitting themselves over this.
Even by the time they reach it, all they're gonna do is just find, like, the Ring of Aquila sitting on the ground inside Roshan.
Oh, that's so ugly.
The cheese will be taken by Ellie.
Alright, Toby, 60 to 65 was not a joke.
That really isn't.
That engage mid might have just delayed the game by 15 minutes.
See, I don't know if it...
10 to 15 minutes.
I don't even if it even just, like, delayed the game. It may have actually changed the result of the game.
That too. It's very possible.
Like, CDEC now, like, they have to repel the attack coming in from Newbie. And this PL is showing time and time again that he's just in a really good position. And technically, if Newbie want to force this hard, they can fight with three PLs. One from the Aegis, one from the buyback.
Yeah.
And obviously the original.
Yeah.
Probably should have started with that one.
I guess that was implied. And he also has
start with the spices,
his actual hero.
And then go for the, like, the herbs and spices, then go back to the original.
There goes the tower. I guess... Oh, they have to defend.
Yeah,
the waves are being pushed too hard here, so at least CDC managed to accomplish that. And okay, considering how passive CDC played with their previous Aegis, there's no way they make an aggressive play until they lose this Aegis on Newbie. So this is 5 minutes of farm for Newbie. Key item acquired, BKB for the Doom. PL should be getting his next item when this Aegis expired. I'm imagining it's just going to be straight into the Butterfly. Seems like a really good choice this game. There are no MKBs yet on the CDC cores. It's either that or it's an Abyssal. And he, like you talked about earlier, jumps in and opens up an Ember and kills him alone.
I'd actually really kind of prefer the Abyssal Blade. And if it's not the Abyssal Blade, like you,
better.
Like you have the confidence to get something more like heavy stat orientated. The Butterfly is still better than something like a Scardy.
Yeah, it's gotta be Abyssal.
Especially
Abyssal
when you have
a
Heart, too.
For sure. They're just the best choices right now.
Yep. Well, Shiki's preparing himself for the mid-defense. She got... Is Kingata actually... I think he can solid this kill up on top lane. Yep.
That's a yes.
That was a Half-Life Phoenix who wandered himself into the Dire Jungle. Now Mu lassos over on Garda. Gonna look for a bit of a revenge and how very quickly BT's in.
That's also a yes.
Tip for tat kind of trades.
Okay.
And Lion actually spent his buyback money. He bought an entire Glimmer Cape just before he died.
Yeah, I think it's a good choice. There's Newbie are not gonna high ground with this just yet. Their bottom wave is way too pushed in. And just not losing his reliable gold. Now, the question is if the Glimmer Cape itself is very good. Not sure who's going to be holding... I guess there's going to be the gem on Batrider, and they've had a pretty... I still think someone's going to die, even if he Glimmers them. They should just die to the PL almost exclusively. Or PL plus Sunray is definitely a kill. So, maybe it's not the right item choice. I'm not sure.
This is a nice thing to have.
Oh.
This is a better initiation to have from XZ. So, Tule... Very burnt down. The Shiva's Guard will trigger, but it's all a little bit too late.
He wasted his BKB too. That's a 10-second.
Oh, he actually burnt it?
Yeah. He died to an impetus, I think. He might have actually survived if that didn't deal pure damage anymore. He died to that, right? No, he died to Weaver. Maybe the impetus didn't even hit. Panic plays.
Could be a little bit of column A, a little bit of column B.
Yeah.
The Gemini attack following or something like that.
Big item. Talked about that earlier.
Yeah.
Now he's safe from Doom, until Doom gets something like, say, a Hex or an Abyssal. Probably one of those two choices for him. Or he goes Refresher and targets other heroes.
This is kind of brutal for a Batrider. Because like Batrider would love to have more like a Yule Scepter so he can trigger it, but he had to go for the Ghost Scepter instead. Yeah. Just because of what the Weaver's currently been doing to him with physical damage. And this item doesn't really transition into anything else. Like, I don't want to say he's 6-slotted, but... You kind of want to have the gem on that Batrider too, or else he can't properly initiate on the Weaver.
Yeah.
But then again, he can't properly initiate the Weaver anyway.
Oh, he can burn the Force Staff and then Lasso.
You'd have to be pretty quick with it.
Yeah, well, even if Weaver does use the BKB, you can do it. So yeah, it's time-lapse, that's the danger. But there are definitely ways of executing that, catching him by surprise. Pretty close game, gotta say. Newbie are not using their Aegis either. Gotta say. It's expiring in 40 seconds.
That's the same.
None of them in this game have been used. This is the third Aegis that just expires, I think. Right? I don't think they used them.
I think I remember the first one being burnt.
Maybe you're right.
Yeah. I'm not gonna split hairs. We at least have Nubi getting aggressive with the smoke, so these are the rarer things we've been seeing throughout the game. Even though like they have been fully expended every time they come back off cooldown, the time between the smokes being available for purchase is just so big. And CDEC, they're around the back, they've got the Hawk down, and right now they're watching Hal pushing the mid. There's a spirit from the Ember already on top of that tower.
Just a quick 5-minute update, the gem is still next to the shop on the bottom right.
I think we took a little longer than 5 minutes. Wow. No, CDEC, you're gonna walk up to this high ground blind. They're going to be doing it. The lasso's over aggressive, but the roar from XD, a very quick follow-up, and Moo's not going anywhere apart from town. Aggressive may actually be doomed, but he got the BKB off, so Tule's not doing anywhere near enough damage until he just keeps that going, and then the Sunray will help him out. They've got the life, they've got the power. Aggressive, he time-lapsed out a large portion of the damage, but Tule's still going ham behind that tier 2 tower. He'll eventually drop to this attack from aggressive. He actually ended up picking up the gem, realizing he needed it to ensure the kill over on the Doom.
He just dropped his Demon Edge. Demon Edge on the floor to pick up the gem.
He was worried about the Shadow Blade from the Doombringer.
Oh, that's actually a really good point. It was on cooldown though.
Yep. And then
here's my read on that situation. If you think they're gonna go get the gem and you drop a Demon Edge to pick up that gem, they could get a Demon Edge instead. That's a really bad trade. Oh my god. Well, it worked. So. But you're absolutely right.
At least it's not a troll drop.
That was a pretty crazy play from CDC to just walk up like that. They end up getting a bad fight, but not a complete disaster. I think they can probably hold this base maybe with one buyback, maybe even zero if they play this very, very well.
Mm-hmm. It was amazing how much physical. I really wasn't ready for that much damage.
Oh, he got forced out.
Nice.
Oh,
the pick.
Oh,
got him. Tried to make.
No buyback.
Oh, no, he's in trouble as well. They can see him quite clearly. Glimmer doesn't help him at all. And he's burning. He's burning from the sprite. It's not going to be enough, however. He'll get back with 190 life, but Hal, he's just going in maybe a little too deep. As Q, nope, there's the blink. Will disjoint the Impetus. But because they dove in this deep, they can't go for the tower, the Sleight of Fist. They actually...
Boom! Oh!
Batrider and Rubick just basically evaporate. Housley's got the Lotus Orb, which return the Roar, so there's no follow-up instantly from the Necro units, but they still find the kill. Newbie, they chase the Glory, they chase the Scouts, they didn't go objective-based gaming, and now they've given CDEC a way to defend, hold the line, and regain control of this map. Whoops.
My analysis of that fight was, what the fuck? That was crazy. That was like the biggest, easily the biggest play of the series there with that aggressive Force Staff. That's such a great play in the moment. I do believe it was Tron who did everything, Force Staff into Telekinesis.
And that's Newbie making the play.
Newbie made the play. They got the Weaver out for 2 minutes. I'm just like, okay, this is at least Rax, and they might actually just take the whole game. 2 minutes, no buyback. True. And then that one cleave crit that gets 2 kills on the back line after they've successfully more or less disengaged just kept CDC in the game there.
You almost want to say it was a bad thing that Sean was so good, because it actually encouraged Newbie to just keep fighting.
I'm not going to say it's a bad play killing a core for 2 minutes at potentially no cost. That is a very good play.
And yeah, but what you lost after wasn't a great play.
If you hear their voice comm...
I think it's good for Chorn, not good for Newbie.
If you hear the voice comm and after that kill, he's like, let's dive them. Then you can blame him for that call.
Yes, that I'm down
the
with.
The play itself, that was actually potentially just flat out game winning.
We may have a moment here. We may have a moment. They may discover the gem.
Oh, there's a gem still, guys.
There is the gem. It's only 51 minutes into a game, and they don't discover Jack.
They actually don't have a gem. That would be a pretty nice pickup. Because aggressive.
Wait, no, they have to have left it behind then. Yeah, they've got two gems on the courier. Both belong to Q.
Maybe they could start.
Yeah,
with
yeah, it. It's gone now. No, it's still there. No, so there's three gems.
Start open some sort of jewelry store.
They left. They're trying to make the drone necklace, like the three jewels.
Yep.
And the drone
well,
necklace.
What if if you like combined three gems into a super gem? What would it do?
It wouldn't drop when you die.
That actually doesn't sound that broken to me, to be honest. It's a really big investment.
Yeah.
And it takes very long before you can get it.
I'm actually almost down for that one.
Maybe it's still a bit broken.
Volvo, please.
Another thing. It's probably
okay, super. But yeah, well, they're not going to have super gem because unfortunately the gem is still down next.
What if
super
you
shop.
Could cast it, like target the ground in a circle somewhere and get true sight there
what,
at a distance?
So you'd end up having like a version of like a Night Stalker ultimate. Because you'd have to give like a true sight vision as well if you
yeah
did that.
You like ground cast, it's like a scan. You can scan an area up to 200 range away and like
and conquer now.
Like an 800. Oh, that's a good game.
Dangerous pass we go. First we found the vegetarian black dragon, and now we've found like
oh yeah, dude. Are there any of those?
No. No, he's not munching on the tree right
Maybe
now.
Maybe it's time for some more cooking.
We are not opening up the cookbook.
Rush us up.
For those out there that were watching the group stage, shout out to you guys.
Alright, this is a very exciting moment, Toby, because now it comes down to who is going to get this Roshan and thereby the cheese, because we know the Aegis won't get used. So it's about who can like start fermenting the cheese in the fountain at this point.
Dude, cheese is only good after it's managed to sit for a very, very long time and go moldy. Alright, so CDEC are going to smoke up. So do newbie. So we basically have we have a field of smokers at the moment. And Moo's gonna be the first one forward. Wait for that Firefly. They're so close. He's waiting for the smoke to break, just like now. Firefly's up, and now CQ. A quick blink blast through, a short range one, but it's been up to kill off that Enchantress, or is it? She's the untouchable, but still gonna get touched up. And Garda getting Sunray down. They've taken out two. They're looking for more. The Roar knows on a PL illusion. XZ not finding the right target. He's gonna lose his life. That blink, that TP out won't work in time. Aggressive has to run himself free. Luckily for him, he went west, and Newbie went east. But they've now lost three heroes. The Beastmaster instantly buys back and loses one of the gems. Super gem delayed even further.
Well, are they going to go for this rush? There was a buyback on the BM. Oh,
it makes a lot of sense to go for the Roshan.
They suddenly got the Hex now on Phoenix too. That's a very, very big item. Now they have a way of breaking the linkage with that, or they can, obviously, you know, just... If they've already broken it, it's a game-winning item right now.
Just use your own abilities. God, Lotus Orb as well on him. Like, how do you even touch this Phoenix when he initially dives in? Like, you can't even disable him when he makes the first jump.
If so, your line is very quick on the trigger.
But if you already have the Lotus Orb on when you dive.
Yeah, well, then you hex each other.
Yeah.
And that's...
And then you get sent back to the very, very start, right?
Or... Yeah.
Yeah.
Which
okay.
is, that's actually good enough.
Okay, Hal must not really be interested in going for this Roshan. He just denied the DD rune that was sitting in the bottom river. So they have no intention, and I kind of agree with him. Like, when the Beastmaster buys back, and you get that Hawk Vision over the Roshan pit, you've got to be thinking, okay, CDEC, they're ready to contest us. Why should we do the hard work for them and bring Roshan down? So CDEC now will five-man smoke, they move the Hawk forward, and Newbie, at this point, they're basically playing Obi-Wan versus Anakin. They've got the high ground at the moment, and CDEC, they're gonna slip themselves into Roshan. Garda moves forward, and the
Why is he standing there? Move!
He's not going for it! Garda's got the time to blink himself away! Cinder and Chill, you haunt! And he's jumping so bad! Enchantress is finally down, they found themselves an opening! Aggressive will BKB himself out, as XZ basically spawns the Necro units to create space. But now they don't actually have the PKB, and Newbie will feel confident enough to go into Roshan. The Hawks will still be available from XZ, however, but there's no Necro units.
Wait, hang on. As Enchantress still got the same items as 25 minutes ago?
Yes.
I was like, okay, this axe has to be coming up.
Multiple times she's had just over 1,000 gold.
All right,
and has not purchased the item.
They do not want a Roche.
I will also explain another reason why I think this has ended up happening.
Maybe it's a bit too risky.
It's because he's purchased multiple gems.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So it's been really expensive for them to try and, like, gain and hold on to Trueside.
In a way, I like Newbie's choice of not taking Roche here, because arguably it is a risky position for them to fight in against the Beastmaster Hawk the Swarm, and of course the Ember, who's starting to deal a lot of damage at this point. At the same time, they have so much margin for error. They have like two or three buybacks, maybe even four, and you know on the other side that there's no buyback on two heroes. On no one at all. They have zero buybacks on the Dire. Oh, Ember has one. Okay, they have one. One buyback.
I would really love it if Howe would actually spend some of his 8,000 gold that's
and
currently
now
sitting
they're
here
going
and now the jump
fight.
Goes, but Howe, he already moved out. The pity was ready for this. Garda, the lands will come forward. He'll be able to keep himself alive with that Glimmer Cape, but aggressive with the BKB. The Noble will finally come out now, but who's he going? Aggressive can't do jack. He's actually been picked up and thrown back, and the BKB is worn off, and he was doomed up, hence no escape mechanisms. Even Shiki has his Lincoln Spear triggered as they dive in deeper. Q looking for that big damage from the Impetus, but it doesn't really do that much when Ellie's got a level life behind him. CDEC without a Weaver for 86 seconds. Roshan is still on the table here for Newbie.
Do something, Newbie.
Well, maybe they could die. Shiki jumps himself in and instantly jumps back out again. There's no disable. It's currently the aura that's there, but then again, Howe was able to chase down the Enchantress in the mid lane. They've got to go down mid, like, they've got to look for a Rax. Like, you got two heroes without buyback, even if they don't have buyback. Like, actually, no, you know the Enchantress doesn't have buyback, she already used it. The only question mark will be, does the Weaver have the money? But he bought a Monkey King card just before that fight began. That's the reason he doesn't have his money. Ember Spirit at least takes care of the creep wave, but Howe already got himself in. So no backdoor regeneration to stop this push from happening. And these illusions are keeping XZ off the front lines. He's actually having to go all the way back to his fountain to regenerate. So they burn the fortification and CDEC. Maybe they just don't take this. Like, unless a second Rax is harassed.
I think they have to give two sides. There's no way in hell they can do anything about this. They can just stand and watch.
The Ember can slow it down. But that's basically... I mean, actually, no, because he doesn't even have the creep wave on top, does he? So you're not even looking at, like, the extra damage coming in with the help of the Battle Fury.
He isn't really damaging Howe right now.
Okay! Oh, there's a jump, blink, lasso, Shiki! He tried to defend him, and because of it, he pays the ultimate price, getting caught out. He's got buyback, 105 seconds on the sidelines, will be negated by the money. But his next death is going to be a very, very long one. But they hold their second lane of Rax. They burn the BKB as well over on the Beastmaster.
I'm not even sure this is worth
that
the
was
buyback.
That was his 10-second BKB.
Okay, so what they basically did there was that they decided defending this Rax and buying back Ember is more important. Because they could have just waited. They have two heroes respawning after 10 seconds. So the moment they engage like that, the risk... You look at the risk reward. They can't kill a hero. They jump on Hound Roaring.
But they can take Roshan.
They can possibly take Roshan now, so that would make it worth it. And I just think I'm so surprised that Newbie just left this here. I think they could have taken it. They had the opportunity to take it for the last 3 minutes.
Too late's gonna come in. The Necro book is just timed out. They didn't have the vision, so the Aegis the Immortal, no one's picked it up yet. Finally, now it's in the hands of the Weaver Bagada, picked up like a ragdoll and sliced in half by the Doombringer. They need to get out of here, CDEC, but the Hex and the Doom are both on aggressive.
Yes,
they're gonna burn the Aegis to the Immortal, which means most of that work for CDEC doesn't count for much. And the Nova, as it hits the ground, is actually going to perfectly set up aggressive. He gets the BKB off, but still, the stun is there. And can aggressive do some work now? That's the question. He's already time-lapse on Shikuchi himself away from the fight. Shiki, oh, they grouped up, Newbie. That slider fist doing some serious damage to the Doombringer, but aggressive, he's still the main prize, and they claim him. 99 seconds on the sideline. They chase after Shiki, and he's able to spirit himself away only up to the Ancient, so not too far away. But you've still got no Weaver again on the field. You've got to repair what's been done to your mid lane. And Newbie are definitely coming in fourth with four buybacks. They can just force the issue.
The gem is still at the shop, by the way.
The 60-minute check.
Now the Roshan pit, on the other hand, is littered with power treads. Oh, XZ!
BKB, he's got enough life to get out of there. But he almost killed off the Doombringer. That would have bought them the space they really needed. But look at Howe again, like he just makes, like he just leaps himself up to that top lane, starts going on the range racks with his illusions and forces Shiki to fight. Burn a little bit of mana if possible, and there's no flame guard available for Shiki. He really does not want to be coming into this engagement. Even if it is up against illusions, it's still problematic. At least XZ's able to get some vision to stop that Hawk.
keep the vision up as long as they possibly can with no weave for 36 seconds. At least now they actually have to concede the top racks and wait for bottom racks.
Progress. Okay, one lane to go. Remember when I said 60 to 65?
Yes, they've got obviously 4 minutes. Your second chance with one.
I didn't even believe in that one.
So just by dumb luck, Zipper is correct.
I have definitely lost the Blitz challenge, but that's okay, because if it's the Blitz challenge, it's probably pretty stupid. Alright.
Oh, nope. Jump by Mu. Caught out Q. Gunner was able to get the Hex off of Q. It doesn't stop from being dragged back into the Sunfire. And there is no way out of that. 72 seconds without your Enchantress. Shiki has burned his BKB. The Weaver is alive again, but nothing can really stop Hal. Even if you do stop him. Yes, it's a Viegas, but he's got himself another life with his Fireback and straight BTs in. They jump in. Chuan! Oh my! Aggressive finally does some good damage, but the Ghost after protecting Chuan for the moment. XZ, he has to use the BKB to run out, and now Hal goes to work. The BKBs are down for CDEC. Protection no longer exists. They're diving all over the place here in Hubie, but they're in deep enough. Okay, well, maybe don't even have to go that deep. Aggressive comes back with a time-lapse, and Ellie, well, he's going to get himself away to safety. The Spider-Fist still can't reach him. Actually, they're fairly low. Maybe they can find a pickoff. Shiki with one hit could do the work, but how? Straight back in again. Shiki gets carved up, and there goes Aggressive as well. This should be the game. GG is the call, and Newbie in 62 minutes will end our night and eliminate the fourth team today. It is going to be CDEC. The TI champions have been eliminated. Almost champions.
Second place.
Runner-up champions. Close. Close to Gardo.
Runner-up champions. We won second place.
Let's go to people that actually make sense.
Man,
my panel.
That was a really crazy game. And, you know, I'm not really sure what to make of it.